I recently received this big parcel, which to no surprise, due to its label, contained the DeltaGo desktop 3D printer. In comparison to other 3D printers I tested so far, this one was quite a bit smaller and lighter. But of course, that does not mean it cannot create some useful 3D prints. So in this video, I will share my experiences I had with the printer so far. The good ones, but also the bad ones. And in the end, we will conclude whether the machine is worth the $450 price tag. Or rather the $350 price tag if you use the coupon code GreatScott. Let's get started. After opening the package, I was greeted by a protective layer of foam, which I had to get rid of before I could lift out the 3D printer. Then I removed the plastic bag around it and also all the cardboard boxes, plastic film and the tape that protected the printer during shipping. And once I grabbed the filament provided by the manufacturer, I noticed that the machine was apparently tested beforehand, since a successful 3D print was attached to the print bed. Nevertheless, I then continued by unpacking the only accessory box for the printer, which aside from the blue painter's tape contained a card with a link to where you can find the setup instructions, a mini USB cable, an SD card adapter and a 12V 5A power supply with the wrong plug for my country. So let's start off by visiting the setup instructions URL where we can find the getting started guides. It tells us to download Cura, add the DeltaGo with its machine settings, include the DeltaGo Cura profile, and so on and on. But that guide is pretty outdated. We actually only need to download the Cura 2 software and the PrintRun software. In Cura, we can then simply add the DeltaGo printer and use the pre-existing profiles, since they seem to work just fine for me. But of course, you can always tweak them to your likings later on. But we're getting ahead of ourselves. First off, I remove the blue painter's tape, move the hot end downwards so that the nozzle touches the aluminum bed, and connected the power and USB cable. After starting the PrintRun software, I typed in this command, which told me that the nozzle had contact to the print bed. So I executed the auto calibration G-code, which tells the machine to probe the height of different parts of the bed so that the perfectly even first layer is pretty much always guaranteed. Needless to say, this feature is not only cleverly implemented, but also makes 3D printing a lot easier. Once the auto calibration was complete, I heated up the hard end to 210 degrees Celsius, which leads me to the next feature of the printer, its LED notification lights. As you can see, it slowly changes to red as the hot end reaches its set temperature. But aside from that, I think it is only useful to illuminate the build platform while the machine is printing. Anyway, next I inserted the filament into the extruder and thus the hot end, extruded a bit and added the blue painter's tape back to the build plates. Afterwards, I executed the logo G-code, which was already located on the microSD card of the printer, and thus started my first print with the machine. As you can see, the printing process worked out just fine, and the quality of the 3D print was also pretty good. So I went ahead and downloaded / imported the 20mm example cube into Cura, and sliced it with a low quality profile. To start the print, I could copy the G-code to the microSD card, insert it into the printer, and use the USB connection to select the code through PrintRun. But what I instead prefer is to rename the G-code to onBoot, which tells the machine to automatically execute the code when it powers up. Now the Q-print did start out pretty normal, but at a certain height, the hard end did not want to extrude sufficient plastic anymore. So I removed the failed print and restarted the process, which sadly resulted in the exact same outcome. It seems like the extruder cannot push the filament into the hot end, which according to the troubleshooting guides means that a hot end is jammed. So according to a listed solution, I pushed the filament into the hot end by hand, quickly pulled it out and cut off the tip. Afterwards, the cube print finally worked out like it was supposed to, and the quality was once again very nice, which means it was time for a true benchmark. Obviously, when talking about a 3D printer benchmark print, we are talking about Banshee, the boat, whose printing process worked out flawlessly. And as you can see, there were some problems with overhangs, but overall I was happy with the quality of the print so far. So the next task was to print something a bit bigger, which once again was no problem for the Delta Go. But after removing the print, I noticed a rather significant warping problem. The reason for that is partly that the printer does not have a heated bed. But instead of searching for excuses, I cleaned the aluminum bed with isopropanol, laid out new strips of painter's tape, cleaned them with isopropanol as well, got myself new brown PLA filament and inserted it into the extruder to give this print another try. Once the printer was finished, I removed the print from the bed and noticed that a bit more care with proper adhesion can solve warping problems easily. For the next test, I visit Thingiverse, where I found this really interesting looking spool holder, which is one accessory that is sadly not included with the printer. But while importing the STL file, I noticed another problem. The print area with its diameter of 115 mm and a height of 154 mm was too small. So just for fun, I scaled down the size of the model and started the print, which, like always so far, started out just fine. But at the end, there was the same problem as before with the clocked hot ends. To confirm this, I tried some other prints, which all began the printing process like usual. But every time, at some point, the extruder started skipping, and the print turned out to be a fail. So to get rid of this problem once and for all, I removed the plastic tube from the hot end, repeated the same procedure as before, just with a lower temperature, and afterwards removed the drive gear in order to clean it properly from all the plastic shavings with a metal brush. Once that was done, I restarted the oversized nut print and finally witnessed a no skipping print, which also featured a pretty good quality. So after printing the fitting bolts with PLA filament as well, it was time to try some other materials. Firstly, I tried some wood filaments, which does not only smell incredible during printing, but also was printed without a problem. Next, I got some copper filaments, which once again was no hurdle for the Delta Go. And if you're interested in how loud this machine is, then I can say that it is not as loud as bigger 3D printers. But it is certainly not a pleasure to work next to it. And the cooling fan, which runs even when the machine does not print, is especially annoying. Anyway, after treating the copper print with a metal brush in order to enhance the copper look, it was time to get serious. Now, since I was on a run at this point, I tried some reflective filaments, which started out just fine, but eventually the extruder could not push it with sufficient force and clogged itself. The reason is simple. This filament is a lot more flexible than the other filaments I tried so far, which sadly also means that any kind of flexible filament cannot easily be printed with the Delta Go. So let's fix their website real quick and move on to the last material test, ABS. Of course, it needs a higher printing temperature and a brim to properly stick to the newly attached painter's tape. But I was still not confident about this since the printer does not have a heated bed. But to my surprise, the nut printed without any problems, even at the first try, and the quality was like always pretty good. So all in all, do I think the printer is worth the money? Well, kind of. I really do like its compact, pre-assembled, high quality looking design and its consistently good printing quality. But on the other hand, there are some nitpicks, like the reoccurring clogging problem, the weird flickering of the LEDs during the printing, and the fact that there's no heated bed. But aside from that, it is an easy to work with printer, which is definitely usable for smaller parts. I hope you enjoyed watching this review. If so, don't forget to like, share and subscribe. Stay creative, and I will see you next time.